Hey everyone, I'm not sure if you're on yet, so if you are, we're in about the 9-10 minute countdown. If you can go ahead and say hello and let me know if you can hear me okay. Again, if you are in the online webinar for the webinar workshop, which we're going to be doing, this is a four-part series for this month. We're going to be doing number one this month. In this webinar, which again is, we'll go into details in a couple minutes, but right now just doing an audio check and a visual check. If you can put today's date and also saying that you can hear me, that way I know you guys have the live webinar versus the old previously recorded, because in the software we do a little duplication thing. That way we don't have to retype out everything from ground zero. But if you can go ahead and put in today's date in the question answer spot and just shoot an email to us, that's how we receive that information right now. We're working on a live chat solution as well. But we're about 8 minutes out. Just wanted to say hi. And if you can at least, again, type in into that chat box, Melissa will be overwhelmed a little bit for a couple minutes there. Again, just let us know. So I'm in the midst of setting up everything here at the house. This is our living room. You can see in the back corner here, over here, I feel like the weather forecaster can't see where I'm at. That's our in-home studio in our three-bay garage that we converted over. If you saw the webinar, that was how I lit it. That will take you to, you know what, let me, I'm going to go off camera here for a split second just to look at, what link did you click? Did you get a follow-up email?
Yeah, that was from the follow-up email.
Thank you for registering. No, not the registering one. Click on, you don't have a reminder one there? We're making sure we're getting through any technical difficulties here. I'm going to shoot over a link, a bypass link that we'll place in the Profit Photographers group for those people that are having any issues. Let me just grab it here. And if you can check the email for me, just see if people are able to hear and see us. And hopefully it's today versus our previous recorded webinar. Let me go ahead and just give us a second, guys. We're, again, that's why we started a little bit early, just to get all the glitches out. Those of you that have been on live webinars before know that it is something. Okay, what's that?
Stephanie says she heard the same name, so Stephanie's on.
Okay, do they give today's date? That way we know that we're on the right. I just want to make sure you guys aren't getting the replay of a previous webinar since we copied and pasted this. So what I'm going to do is open up a browser here and send to Melissa through Facebook a link that she can post in the Facebook group just in case we have any last minute people coming in and they can't get in for some reason. Doop. All right, so there is a link there. If you can post that into the Facebook group, that way if anybody's in there and they ask if there's issues, we'll be okay. All right, so we're about 5 minutes out. If everybody, whoever's in the webinar, if you can just say hello, tell us where you're from. If you're open to let us know your experience with lighting, photography, lighting in general, if you can let us know like a little bit of information, if we have the opportunity, we'll share that here at the beginning. And then once we dive into the webinar itself, we'll be staying pretty focused. So again, if you can hear us and see us properly, hopefully you can. This will be on replay later today and for the next several days. For those of you that do miss it, you'll be able to catch it in that context. So we're going to be getting started in a couple minutes. Have my one survival piece, which is my water. Nearby. Okay, good, good. So those that have logged in recently, hopefully, I did get an email about a half hour ago of people saying they could hear me because we still have the old link, the replay of the previous one. So Again, excited that we have Stephanie that said she could hear us today's date. So that's the important thing, is to make sure everybody can tune in properly. So again, we're just wasting a little bit of time here before we get rolling. It's about 12, we got about four minutes to the official start time. And even then, we might give a minute or two for people. I see people coming in, definitely viewing. We use a piece of software that's a little glitchy, and we do it through Google Live, Hangouts Live, that streams through YouTube. So we have to share that link, and sometimes there's some complicated pieces with that. So again, we're going to be getting started in about 4 minutes officially. If you have the opportunity, if you're in the proper spot, if you're seeing this through directly through YouTube Live and or through Google Hangouts Live, we're not going to be able to see your questions directly. But if you log in, if you're in the Profit Photographers Facebook group, there's a direct link in there. And that way you'd be able to actually submit questions to us and let us know that you are there. But so those of you that are on, if you can just give a shout out through the messaging, let us know. You know, who you are, where you're from, if you want to share any information as far as the actual, you know, your background with studio lighting, because a lot of people are brand new to studio lighting. Again, keep in mind, this will be a limited replay as well. We'll have it over the next couple of days. So for those of you that run in late or had to leave early, you'll be able to capture the whole thing. So again, if you're in, congratulations. We'll be starting in a couple minutes. So I had to keep talking, even in this dead air space to, again, if you have the ability to share, where you're from, who you are, any information as far as your background. Once we get started though, we will, because there's a lot of information. I'm going to try to get in on this, about hour and 15, hour and a half, webinar. And the reason we have to do that, I'd love to go longer, but, we do have a DuPont executive coming in. Into our home studio this afternoon, and we are doing a headshot for them. So we had to relocate all the gear back in to do their headshot for them. And I see Melissa's in the background making some notes that she's probably going to pass through to me in a little bit. But again, if you're able to share, let us know that you can hear and today's date. That way we make sure that you're not on the replay link that we accidentally had in the software originally. That was getting some errors, and some people I think potentially might be looking at that old page. So if we do get random people hitting us up, not telling us today's date, then we might be including a new link for them just so they refresh the page, basically. So again, I'm going to be staying hydrated here as we go through. Okay. So it looks like we got a lot of people piling in now. Again, we're about a minute and a half, 2 minutes away just from the official start. Not sure those of you that are in the Profit Photographers Facebook group, we announced last night, we were really, really excited that we formally officially launched, did a quiet soft launch within the group of our Profit Photographers book that we finally got published. Went through about a year and a half worth of process, but we finally got it together, and it is live on Amazon.com. right now, and we were told it takes about 6 to 8 weeks to get through a certain system where, you know, book resellers like Barnes & Noble and other smaller bookstores will have that opportunity to carry the book as well. So we're gonna have to wait about a month and a half, 2 months for that to start trickling out into the real world. But it is on Profit Photographers or on Amazon.com, which we're really, really excited about. So again, we're going to just wait a minute or two more. We're on the button right now, so we're just going to wait a couple more minutes just to see who else that we slowly get in, because I'm watching the number of viewers keep popping up here. So if you're just tuning in right now, if you can let me know if you can hear us fine, that gives me a better idea to know that I'll be able to communicate with you properly, because I want to make sure the sound quality and the video quality is good. And I am going to attempt to record this locally as well. So we're going to do another test right now, because if this slows down the process, if it takes down the resources of the computer, I want to be able to know that. So we're going to go ahead and get started here in a minute. So again, I'm now recording in the background, so I need to let I need to know from you guys if this is creating the signal, if it's making it choppy or if we're okay. Because if it starts to lag, if the because I'm using the MacBook Pro here, if we have lag in the quality, it's great that I'll have a better quality version here locally that I can upload later on. But I don't want to frustrate everybody that's on live. So if you can let me know that you're this is the point after the me recording it locally, if you guys are keyed in and there's no lag, then I'll keep that going. Otherwise, I'll go ahead and drop off the screen flow. That way we don't screw up anything. I have Melissa, there's about a 30 second lag right now. So I'll have Melissa start checking the emails just to make sure. So anything in there, Melissa? We're gonna go ahead and get started again. I'm seeing the number just doubled actually in the last minute. So let's just give a minute or two more just to make sure we get everybody in here. Wow, it keeps increasing really, really well. We had a little over 400 people register. So it's something that we're excited to, it's a very big number. I think is the most that we had people register. It was a little over 400 people that registered. So knowing that everybody's gonna make it, even if we get a good portion of everybody, which it looks like we are really, really excited.
Pretty good. So it skips a little bit, but not too bad.
It skips a little, okay. Probably, you know what, I'm gonna sacrifice and not do the screen flow because I'd rather you guys have a better quality. And if it's skipping, that's just gonna frustrate some of you. So the only downfall to that is that okay, so I'm gonna turn that off then. All right, so let me get rid of that. That just popped up the screen. We're not gonna save that. All right, let me turn off a couple pieces here that way. So let me know if the quality increased back. So, because I rather have consistency here and just closing a couple apps that I had open earlier on. So those of you that are on that can hear, hopefully the quality bumped back up again. Again, we just were trying to do a test there to see if we could do a live recording locally. That way we could actually give a better broadcast and replay. But it looks like it created a lag in the system. So what I'm going to do now is just pop over. I'm still going to be here, but I'm going to pop over to a screen share. So you're going to lose me there for a split second. And hopefully you guys can see that. Are you streaming on it as well, Melissa? Or you, okay. Okay. Could it, if all of you can let me know if the screen shares is working properly, you'll see photography 101, lighting 101, sorry, and a picture of good friends of ours. That, and if you're on that, then get out of that. That way it doesn't cut down the streaming because we'll be looping back. So what we're going to be doing today is talking about studio lighting. Now, the challenge, though, is that a lot of people get scared right out the gate because we have two different types of shooters. We have those that are more on the creative side, and they just want to, you know, quickly know information. They want to go out and start creating art, and they know very limited of the technical side. And then we have the polar opposite. We have people on the whole other side that they're very, very technically driven. And when they get into workshops or training pieces like this that we're doing today, they start glazing over because the person instructing goes very, very technical. The challenge is in about an hour and 15 minutes or so, how can I give you both sides of this a little bit without totally overwhelming you? Because, you know, we typically do a very intense, for about 10 years now, we do a 10-hour lighting intensive workshop. And I'm gonna give you through this webinar series, the four pieces in this training that we're doing, I'm gonna give you four segments of that workshop. But we can only do so much within the context of the time that we're given on these. So the challenge here is that delicate balance that I'm going to give you enough usable information. You're going to be able to go out in the real world, start applying this, but we're not going to have the ability to do like the hands-on aspects. And that's something that I just need to rely on you guys outside of the webinars to do that. Now, I'm going to slowly go through. We're going to bounce back and forth between this the slides and besides that, we're going to flip back and forth with me coming on live. So there'll be a little technical pieces back and forth, because it's not like we're a major recording studio where we have 20 people here. This is very grassroots between Melissa and I going back and forth. So Melissa's in the Prop Photographers Facebook group, just making sure that everybody's getting in. Looks like we're going to be starting here pretty quickly. So what I want to do first, and some of you that have been in our classes, webinars in the past, know a little bit about me and our background and Melissa's background, but just want to kind of cover a few different things, just to, as far as the context, as far as lighting is concerned. Now, on my end, I had the luxury of learning many, many years ago from top photographers in the fashion and glamour world, because I paid them tens of thousands of dollars to learn about studio lighting, about different aspects of lighting, because I was just intrigued by it. And one of my very first mentors was over 20 years ago in Los Angeles. And I remember the first shoot that I went out with them. It was about, I think it was 26 or 27 lights to illuminate the set in order to photograph one image for a cover of a magazine and also a featured article. And it was just, the intensity was just so mind-blowing. And keep in mind that at that time frame, this is all digital, non-digital world. This is when you had to put a Polaroid back in the back of a medium format camera, take test shots just so you could look at how the lighting was falling. And you didn't know until like a week later, when everything came back from the lab, if your exposure was on or not. So it's something that a lot has changed over the years. But I learned right out the gate. It was almost like saying that I wanted to learn how to play basketball, and my first mentor was Michael Jordan, and I got to play with Michael Jordan directly. So when it came to lighting, right out the gate, over 20 years ago, I just went right to where I knew I could skip steps and learn more of the extreme right out the gate. So for me, over the years, it's ironic, because I used to have tons and tons of gear, and I've been slowly moving it backwards and becoming more and more simplified in lighting as technology has changed and allows us to do a lot more and get creative and take risks. My previous life, you know, I had a camera since I was 7 years old. And it's something that I come from a very, very poor background, but my grandmother gave me $20 and I was able to buy a Canon AE-1 back when I was right around seven, and played around with it a lot. And I just naturally had a love for photography growing up. Took 4 years of it in high school. Out of high school, I actually had a bad dream. I was taking pictures of the Easter Bunny and Santa Claus at the local mall as a failed photographer in my head. And because of that, I ended up going into the real estate industry. And I did very, very well in that world. Went from a very poor background to a multimillionaire, living very, very well and having that excess money to be able to travel around the world and learn off of others while I was teaching sales and marketing training at a certain point during those years for a major real estate brand, and went around and taught people around the United States. And I was very lucky that I learned a lot about lighting with that excessive money that I made and mentored off of top people. And going into the digital world, I noticed that with an increasing amount of people that are owning cameras, that lighting has really separated me from everybody else. And while I have the business knowledge as well, it's just something that it's really important to understand that this day and age with technology, you have the ability to transition from a natural light shooter into a real, you know, not just studio, but, you know, we use lighting just to supplement. You know, there's not the perfect scenario where natural light is always perfect all the time. And we're going to go through some of that today. So normally in my workshops, this is one of the slides that I would put up, because I want to know everybody else's background experience. I did have, we did ask a couple minutes ago what that would be. But in order to keep the flow of this online class, I'm going to keep it pretty limited just on my experience and give you a little background. Now, I was on top of the world in my real estate company. I was retired. I was doing very, very well. And right around 8 years ago, actually very close to 8 years ago, it was February 4th, 2008. So look at that. We were like on point, like just several years ago, I got a call and found out that family had stole money out of my company. laundered a very large sum of money out of my company, and our company froze up in a matter of a couple weeks completely. So I went from rags to riches back again, and found myself homeless within a couple months, no car, no houses, none of that stuff, and about $3 million in debt against my name instantly. And my whole life shuddered and shocked myself. And at that time, I had a Canon 10D. Ooh, high-end camera, right? Still at that time, I had my Pentax 645N. I was a medium format shooter, and I had that for years. But it's something that, as far as digital was concerned, I had a Canon 10D. And interestingly, it was a very rough time in my life, but it's something that I had a limited number of lenses, had some lighting, had studio lighting that I had through the years. And outside of being depressed initially, I had to go through this range and figure out how to separate myself from everybody else. And one thing I noticed very quickly is, outside of having the business skill sets and knowing about in-person sales, marketing, branding, you know, those type of things, because that's what I used to teach in the real estate world to tens of thousands of people a year. And it's something that I knew with the photography side, if I was going to reinvent myself, I knew I had to separate myself from the incredible amount of people that owned a digital camera. And that's only increased since then. Like it seems like every holiday season, there's a whole slew of new professional photographers that pop up, and there's nothing wrong with that, but you definitely had to look at the oversaturation in all of our markets and say, okay, what can I do to separate myself from everybody else? And if there's a huge amount of people that are out there that constantly are claiming that they're a natural light shooter, typically that means they haven't learned or hadn't had the opportunity, or maybe it's an investment, time, or finances that they haven't been able to invest either that learning aspect or financially into the gear to separate themselves from everybody else. So what I'm hoping that you're going to get out of today is just the starting point, because again, each of these four classes are going to separate. We have a separated out, and I'll share that in a minute, but it's something that I'm hoping that we just have the starting point just for you to understand the importance of lighting, how it can change a situation for you. We're going to go into initially some studio gear, where I'll flip out of this keynote presentation and have, you'll be seeing me live. We're going to take you through some of the gear that we have in the studio. Some of it can be overwhelming. You're going to look at all this gear and go, wow, but you have to understand it's taken years for me to collect all this. And I can tell you, when we go out on the majority of weddings and portrait sessions, everything, we're very minimalistic. We don't have like 80, 90% of everything I'm going to show you today. So let's go ahead and start rolling in. But the first thing I want you to do, especially in online training, one of the frustrating things that I find on a personal end is it's so easy to get distracted. So easy. So if you could close out your Facebook, put your phone, we're so in tune to that, right? Put your phone on mute. If you can get rid of all the other distractions, you know, because you really need to, in the past, we always used to learn better because we were isolated. We could only focus on training, and we weren't multitasking, having 45,000 other things going on at the same time. And the moment that you take your mind off of this, it's hard to get back on it. And that's the thing, is if you could just take your time, turn your phones on silent, put them away. If you can, you know, close out your browser, your extra browsers where you might have Facebook and other distractions up, focus totally on this, and hopefully that attention to detail will help accelerate you even more than just having those 25 things going on at the same time. So if you're in a live workshop, I definitely make you turning off your phones right now. So actually, before we begin with natural light, let me just go over a review very, very quick as far as how this webinar series is set up. So this is a lighting 101. So ironically, we're going to talk about some advanced things, because the advanced stuff technically is in the 101 information, and people so quickly these days want to skip steps, skip ahead, and learn all the advanced stuff, and they really don't have the foundation set up. And really, this is how those of you that have been involved in our webinars and our classes in the past. It's actually how we start our Profit Photographer's book as well. That it's something that we always look at everything from a solid foundation. So you need to deconstruct anything that you might have in your head or things that you've been playing around with, and you really need to come back to the bare bones. So we're going to introduce you today some aspects about studio lighting. We're going to go through some gear pieces here as well, just to tell you know, explain so you can understand some of the tools that's used. We're not going to get highly technical today. Now, the second webinar that we're going to be doing, it will be focused on camera settings, talking about metering and some of the science behind that. Now, I'm going to present it in a way that's going to try to be as much layman's terms as possible instead of getting highly, highly technical, because a lot of people do glaze over when you start talking about law of the inverse square and other aspects that it ends up being too overwhelming for some of you. And again, this group most likely is 50-50 split, just like how we have people in classes in general, is that we find that you have the half of the room that are highly technical and they're on the nerd geek side, and there's nothing wrong with that, where you want to know all the digits and the science and the specifics. And then we have the whole other side of the room, typically, that they just want to get it, understand it, feel it, and go out and do it. They're not sitting there clicking three stops on purpose. They're going to feel it and adjust and change. So we're going to give a little bit of mix. That way we don't lose 100% of any of you. In the third webinar that we're going to do in this series is in studio. So what are we doing as far as in studio? And then we're going to build that up. We're going to start out the gate on that webinar from simple one light setups. Because I tell you what, when we do weddings and we do creatives, a lot of times when we're on the fly, it's one light setups. When we do a good portion of headshots, I'm going to show you some examples here in a couple minutes. They're one light setups, and we'll build it up that way it's not overwhelming for you. And on the fourth webinar, we're going to talk about real world situations where we go on location a lot. Like we just got a hit up a couple minutes ago before the webinar. Melissa took the call and communicated, but it was a dentist office that hit us up and asked us if we can photograph, I think they said 16 people. Yeah, 16 people. After this webinar, we're going to have a DuPont executive come in that's oversees the marketing and branding for DuPont Company, and we're going to be doing her professional headshot here at the in-home studio. But we go on location a lot and do full-blown studio setups, commercial lifestyle shoots, for different purposes. Sometimes it's for magazines, sometimes it's just for marketing materials, or we have some people that come in for Match.com or LinkedIn headshots. Like, you just never know. But also events, like we go out, we photograph a lot of events. Sometimes it's a fundraiser, sometimes it's a wedding. All this stuff, you know, there's the element of lighting, because those of you, if you're going to get into event photography at all, you need to understand lighting, because you cannot guarantee that the lighting that's available in a space at any point in time is the type of light that you need to make people look flattering. So we're going to go through these type of pieces within the webinar series. So let me back up this slide since I had it out. So where it all begins is natural light. So of course we're going to be talking about studio lighting, but like today we have an overcast day where we're at, and you know, that hard sunlight that comes in, you know, there's different pieces and quality of light. And when that sun is in the middle of the sky and it's beaming down on you, it's very, very harsh. And when that cloud cover happens, it's interesting, because then the clouds become the equivalent of a softbox. And now the sun hits the clouds and the atmosphere, and then all of a sudden we have nice even light that's outside, which is what we're experiencing today, and works out perfectly for us doing the webinar when I pop on live here. So what are the pros and cons? Because a lot of us are focused on natural light. So the pros and cons you need to look at, on the positive side, hey, it's available. Here it is. Like what's around? What's the ambient light? And when I say natural, that could be ambient light as well, like turning on the light that's in a venue, or could be in a house or location, wherever you're at. Maybe that's quality light. Maybe it's good enough. It could be, again, going outside and looking around. It could also be light that's outside at night. Like you could go outside, there could be a lantern, there could be a reflection, there could be anything that's in the real world that you can use. But let's take today as an example. Some of you might be natural light shooters and you're going outside, and but it's raining out today and that person just came in to town, they need a good headshot, blah, 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 and you don't know what to do because you're jammed up because now it's raining outside. It's always weather permitting. Like, it could have been snowing outside. It could have been raining. It could be like 110 degrees. I don't know your location, but sometimes there's limitations as far as the location. Sometimes there's limitations as far as, you know, the quality of light that the world is giving us at that moment in time. So you need to look back and forth, and also keep in mind, like, that's what everybody else is doing. So from even from a perceived value standpoint, from a client standpoint, if you just grab your camera and you go out and start photographing, you might have a great lens. You might have that 50-1.2 lens and it has a beautiful limited depth of field and it's going to blow everything out in the background. And that's really cool. But I'm telling you that in the mind of the consumer, they see when you start bringing out other tools and you're doing some lighting pieces and everything, there's a huge perceived value that'll separate you from everybody else. Now, there's a lot of different ways that we can control and modify natural light, and we'll be going into that in a couple minutes. But there's just some pros and cons that you have to think about when you're dealing with natural light. And if we were talking about lighting, photography lighting, and we're not acknowledging natural or ambient light, we would just be doing it a disservice. So, like on an engagement session here, one of the this is just a couple. It's a perspective shot. I normally talk about this in a different presentation about different perspectives and everything. But, you know, you have that nice wraparound light. You know, here's one at Longwood Gardens that we photographed on a hill. So, you know, we just love the opportunity of having that natural light that's around us. Here's Mia. Her husband's actually a high-end fashion photographer, highly published, works with Ford models. And I had the privilege of photographing their wedding. But here we've got this beautiful light that's coming. You can see the direction, the dimension of the light that's skidding across the space here. And so keep in mind that even though we're getting into the lighting and everything, it wouldn't have done this photo justice if I brought a light from the left-hand side and made it really flat, even light. Like the contrast, the quality of light that's happening, like that, it's something you work with what's there when it makes sense. A lot of times on weddings, we try as much as possible, especially the earlier part of the day, to limit our artificial light. But it's something that if you got to look for the light, you have to see it. You have to see where it's coming from, where it ends, like what makes sense. You know, and then you have situations where it's still ambient light, but you can push your camera purposely to go in a direction where you can, you know, capture an image. Like we did a backlighting on this photo originally, but the silhouette just made it so much more interesting. And this is just what these are just random images I grabbed off my Facebook page, this morning for the webinar. But these aren't specific images that I would like show off that are my greatest work type thing. But just something that there is natural qualities that are existing that are around that you need to look. So even though we're going to talk about light from a standpoint of us controlling light, you always have to remember also you still can push your camera to do things with the available light. So again, we have like very flat, you know, wraparound lighting, you know, it's coming in that you have on those days. Then you have the transition of that hot light coming in. Then you have where you can purposely at certain points of the day push your camera to purposely have silhouettes and then grab that vibe that's coming in. So I'm not against natural light. And I think that's a lot of people think for some reason that when you're talking studio lighting that photography, you know, any type of lighting and photography, that everybody always forgets you still embrace the natural light that's around us all the time. So going from that though, we have to talk about, and really I probably shouldn't even say studio lighting. This is lighting in general where we're creating, we're introducing, we're artificially bringing it in. It's not what's available light that's there right now. And there's pros and cons to that as well. So I tell you what, I used to do things on my own for years and I used to beat myself up. I would come in on a headshot session on location by myself trying to save a couple bucks, and I would be carting in four or five bags slowly into a location. I've been on trains, I've been on planes, you know, with this overwhelming amount of bags and gear, and it gets very, very overwhelming. And it's something you have to think through more, especially these days with baggage fees just about on everything that we get on anymore. But also the weight of everything. So there's some pros and cons to it. You know, we can go out and just shoot naturally. You can run and gun and shoot and then leave, and there's no setup or breakdown or anything like that. When it comes to dealing with lighting that we're going to introduce, there's going to be a setup aspect to that. And that changes the dynamics of it. Now, it also is limiting to what your budget is. So some of the challenges when you're getting into this outside of knowledge is some of you are, you know, you look on the forums and you see all these great photographers and they're photographing with the Profoto B1s and the B2s. And you're like, oh my goodness, I wish I had $2,000 per light to spend on a light. And it's just not realistic. And, you know, you're on a budget and it's like, okay, what can I do for $200? We just had somebody hit us up the other day that specifically asked exactly that. Like they had a $300 budget and they're still scared of strobes. So we talked about using constant light, which we'll be talking about in a couple minutes. And they found an inexpensive set, which good starting point, but it's something that sometimes it's cost prohibitive. Like I'm going to show you a lot of gear and, you know, I have a really good investment in everything that I've spent over the years, but it's taken me years to get there. And sometimes it's a little intimidating when you listen and you hear and you learn from other photographers that do a lot with studio lighting. But the other cons is that you could have a space limitation. We've gone into some situations where we're told they have a big conference room and that's where we're going to do the headshots at or something. And we walk in and it is a 9x10 room, you know, and we're like, oh my goodness, we got to switch up real quick. We just had this happen actually last month where we walked in an attorney's office and setting up, we brought our main studio gear in, but we always make sure we have our speed lights as well. And we'll go over detail about that. But, they wanted three setups all of a sudden. It was like, whoa, we can't set up, break down. And the spaces that they gave us was like a lobby area that was like 4 feet wide by about 10 feet. And there was no way we've gotten our higher level gear in there. So we created some very quick, fast speed light setups balanced with the ambient light that was in the room. And we pulled off some incredible headshots very, very quickly. But when you looked at the gear, it was not the high-end studio strobes type thing. So again, there's a weight issue. There's a time issue. The staffing sometimes, you know, I recommend these days, I always bring an assistant, sometimes two assistants. Like when we did the several day branding shoot for DuPont company, we had three of us that came in because I didn't want to take a risk of having to be in multiple places because we were moving around between several locations to do their lifestyle editorial branding photos. So here is just some quick examples. Here's a friend of ours that came in a couple weeks ago for a quick headshot, down and dirty, simple. This is a one light setup. It is actually on a white background. So we'll be covering that more in the future. But this is a one light setup. This is our friend Marissa. And but very clean, very simple. It's what she was looking for. We gave her all these other options because we showed her different variations as far as what we could do. And this is the direction that she wanted to go in. We took her through a various poses as well. And this is the one that she selected. Here is a three light setup. You can actually see in the guy's eyes, the reflector that we use. And we'll talk about that in a couple minutes. But you can see what's called rim lighting that's coming in on the side. That's the highlights that's coming in. It's actually coming from behind him. So we have two lights from either side. It's actually a white cloth background behind him. But because of the distance that we have, it falls off into a gray tone. And we have one key light. We actually, in this case, we used a beauty dish, which we'll go over and show you in a couple minutes. So here's an engineer at GE Aviation, GE's General Electric. They're one of our clients these days. And so here we actually have because we were doing different orientations, we have to mimic a lot of things. Like I prefer not to have the powder blue background, but previous photographer photographed a bunch of engineers, and this was the look and vibe that the previous photographer had. So we had to know how to recreate and duplicate very closely. So I actually had to go out and buy that background before the session and do some tests to make sure we were going to pull it off. But there is a light going to the background. There's one light that's the rim light. You can see it casting over the head. It's a little hot up there, but also onto the shoulders, nice and evenly there. And one light from the front, very large light source. but it's a clean, professional, simple, it's what they were looking for. And we had to mimic what another photographer gave us. So sometimes you walk into that. We used to, for several years, I decided not to renew the relationship because we're just too busy these days. But we photographed all the Miss Delaware USA pageants as well as winners for the state level. And this is a young lady, Rachel, from a couple years ago. This is a five light setup here. So a little bit more intense, a lot of rim lighting, a lot of color going on in the back, all those type of things. And those of you that like to learn how to do this, we do have another webinar on how I lit it, and that's already up on profitphotographers.com. You can actually watch that free webinar and see exactly how I lit this one. We just did it a couple months ago, and I had Melissa step in and help out as the model to duplicate the vibe as far as what we did with this shot. But these are a little bit more involved. Here's just a quick behind the scenes. We were a bunch of us helped out other photographers last year at Shutterfest. It was like an informal get together, and several of us put several sets together. And this particular setup here, it's a little overwhelming. We see here, but we have a five light setup that's happening in this particular setup here. So we're not going to get this complicated today. We're not going to talk about, but I just show you sometimes what goes on, you know, behind the scenes. It's a lot of gear, and this is going to be intimidating for some people. But the thing is starting at the zero and working our way up slowly to understand. Here's Diana. She came in on with her kids at a lighting workshop that I did several years ago. Very lucky that she's getting remarried. And we're going to Puerto Rico in about 2 months to photograph her wedding, full-blown wedding in Puerto Rico. So you never know where your clients are going to come from. But she's a yoga instructor. You can see her son's up. But we had fun there. But this is a two-light setup. So there was a light that was cast on the background and one key light on them. It was a very, very large setup, what's called a V-flat. And that's something we'll talk about later on as well. But lighting does not have to be complicated. It was nice and even, clean. Here's a one light setup of a friend of mine, Heather. I don't do maternity sessions too often, but when people do hit me up, I wanna do something a little bit more creative. And this is something involves what's called a rim light. And that's something that we'll be talking about in the other series of webinars in this series as well. Here's another one light setup. That's actually a photography umbrella. We were not expecting the rain to happen during this engagement session. Earlier on, I had a photo of Mia that was laying down in the bed on her wedding day. And this is her husband, Herman, who's a fashion photographer. And we were in Philadelphia and we were not planning for the rain. And I had my assistant run and grab one of our umbrellas that we use from time to time in the car, and you know, that we use as a shoot through, and it became the light source. The actual assistant is about 3-4 feet behind them on that light. So lighting can be used, as you can see here, wouldn't have worked as well. And it's interesting that one light served as the key light because it wraps around that umbrella. It's also the light that's creating the rim light behind them, and it also is the light that's capturing all the rain in motion. It freezes it for that split moment in time. Here's a band, American Buffalo, that I photographed a few years ago for a magazine. And this is actually just a one light setup. So on location, here's another one with a group called Bombs Away, where I was actually on the ground with a ring flash, with a ring light that I had my camera through, and I was laying on the ground photographing them. It was very, very aggressively hot and contrasty that day. The sun was out very aggressively, and that's a little missile bomb type thing a local skateboard shop had. So we just played around with that because of their branding and everything. And there's the typical location. So this one's a little contrasty here, but again, off-camera flash, you know, you can come in. I had an assistant at that time. We had an assistant that had held a pole for off-camera flash, so it can be used for weddings and everything. You know, we have, in this case for a wedding, we have two off-camera lights coming from either side of the canopy that are actually in the canopy itself. And then the canopy becomes the light source. So the light just pours in everywhere. And here I am standing on the outside with only a trigger on my camera. So lighting itself comes in all like it can be used in all directions. It's funny because I only had a limited amount of time, so I pulled several things here from me and Herman's, even though their wedding was several years ago. Here we just had a simple rim light coming in, but you know, had a key light that was coming off the flash that was actually dialed down a little bit just so the rim light was a little bit more powerful. And these are things that we'll be talking about in detail that you can use in weddings, engagement sessions, family portraits, you know, events, you know, all over the place. So what I want to do now is we're going to flip into some of the gear, some of the equipment, because I want to at least show you guys a little bit about, you know, real world stuff. So I'm going to get out of this keynote. I'm going to follow along on the keynote for myself personally, but I'm going to get out just so I can show you guys. Hey, I hope you guys actually were seeing the screen flow. Do you know if they were seeing the screen flow? Did you test that? Yeah. Okay. I'm hoping you guys were. Otherwise, you're looking at me the whole time. So that's the beauty of real world. I just saw a button that said present to everyone, and I didn't click it. So I don't know. Do you know if you saw that? Okay. Okay. Well, hopefully you guys saw that. I'm back real quick. And if I didn't disappear, I apologize. That means everybody's been looking at me while I'm sitting here staring into the screen and talking. So what I want to do right now, I'm going to actually flip so I can see this piece here. But I'm going to talk about the gear and the equipment a little bit. Now, those of you that have a camera, so actually let me come back so I can see both of these at the same time. So I have a little protective thing on here. I'm going to take this off. It just helps for me for resale value. So when I go to sell this later on, it's not all banged up. So I have the Canon 5D Mark IIIs. I have a couple of them. And there's a difference between on-camera and off-camera flash. Now, the interesting thing that you learn with a lot of the pro-level camera bodies, the prosumer and the pro levels, is they don't have pop-up flashes. So the quality of light that comes out from a pop-up flash that comes right out at you, it's very, very, it's horrible. You know, it's the same thing with like your iPhones and everything else that you guys use, that, you know, you're looking at you're looking at very specific, like that light's coming right at you up here, coming right at you. And it's very flat. It's not flattering. And really just like what you're seeing now, how from the window, the light's hitting me and cascading over and falling off, that creates dimension. So now I can see highlights and shadows and everything. So that's something that, you know, is very, very important. So when you have on-camera flash, the trick is that, and there's a difference between on-camera and off-camera. So when you have that little pop-up flash, those of you that are new, understand that most professional photographers are not going to use that pop-up flash. Even if your camera has it, they're not going to use that because it's very close to the point of view of the lens, which means you're going to get a lot of red eye a lot of times. And also, it's unflattering because it's coming straight in and it doesn't look great. So we want to take the camera off axis. So a lot of you will have, hopefully all of you, have it what's called a hot shoe on here. And the reason hot shoe, because it is going to send a pulse here. And those of you that have certain cameras, it'll read the settings and be able to adjust. And we'll talk about that detail in a little bit. But you're going to most likely have what's called a speed light. Now, this speed light has an adapter on it. So don't get as focused on this piece right here. We'll talk about that in a couple minutes. But the moment that I take and I go off axis, so when I put this on the hot shoe, and now I'm going off axis with the light, it's now going to have a little dimension to it, but it's still basically the same point of view here. This is not attractive light coming straight ahead. Now, the good side is though, if you do have a pop-up flash, the moment that you go from that pop-up flash, it's so small, it's probably like a quarter inch by like an inch, 2 inches big, and you go to this head, the moment you do that, and this is talking about quality light, and we'll get into more detail about that in camera settings and everything in the next webinar, but the moment that you increase the size of a light, okay, it's going to get softer. So we've just gone from this little tiny flash, and think about it like a flashlight. If I just held that up, see how contrasty that is? Hard highlight, hard shadow. We don't want that, you know? So it's something you don't want that type of light. You don't want, so when it's really small, it's really contrasty. So it's not going to look as pleasing. The moment you enlarge the light, it's going to get softer. And if you can take it off axis somehow, that's why you'll see a lot of the traditional photographers out there. They have the big in stroke form brackets. I used to use those years ago too, but they're trying to take the light off. You'll see them with the bracket systems and everything. I don't do that anymore because all the modifiers are so different now. So right now, the whole idea is, can you first enlarge the light source? Now this is on camera flash still. So this is, even though we're saying off camera a lot, this is still on the body. Like, so this is something, now I can modify it. I can change in the moment that I do something different. And you'll hear people talk about bounce light, and we're here in this house. It's got a beautiful white ceiling that's not too high. So if I just turned it this way right now, the light would actually hit the ceiling and bounce down onto my subject, and it'll be a little bit more pleasing. It will cast a little bit of shadow depending on the direction of the light. But anything that you can do to modify this light to enlarge it, and we'll talk about different modifiers in a couple minutes, but the whole idea is the larger the light source, the softer the light. And that's also in relationship to the subject. So our largest light source that we have in the world is the sun, okay? So the sun is incredibly far away. And because it's so far away, it's like that that piece that, you know, it's way, way, way out there, right? So what happens is it has a harsh feel to it because it's just a little pinpoint in the sky. If that sun was right on top of us, outside of burning and killing existence, but if it was on top of us, it would wrap around like the entire thing. So that the closer the light source is, and how large it is in relationship to the subject, it wraps around a little bit more. It's less harsh, and we'll be going more involved with this as we actually do the live lighting demonstrations in the third and the fourth. But right now, just understand that the larger light source, so you do want to invest in these type of speed lights. There's a ton of different brands out there. I'm not going to get involved with that for the purpose of this webinar today, but it's just something I want you to keep in mind, that the moment that you enlarge the light source, it gets softer, okay? Now, we can put modifiers and everything on as well. So now what I just did, though, is I just took it off because that's my natural thing to do, is now what we can do, so with the like with the Canon and the Nikons and everybody else has similar competitive pieces and products, is this is like a little commander unit here. Now I can actually send a signal to this light. So now it's off camera. So now do you see how that sun, the light's coming from here and it's cascading over? That looks really natural. It's very pleasing. But if I was facing directly into it, it'd be flat. And a lot of you that are new to lighting, you're scared of shadows. And that's when you can see a lot of times a new photographer, they're deathly afraid of shadows. So even when they get into studio lighting and they do all this stuff, the normal setup I see is two, like an umbrella over here and then an umbrella over here, because they're scared to see a shadow somewhere. And you'll see the sign of a professional photographer or pro. There's cases where you need the flat lighting and you're going to do that on purpose. But most of the time you're looking at carving light, you're looking at creating dimension, you're looking at creating highlights and shadows on purpose. So the whole idea, the only way you can do that is to take the light off the camera. So you have off camera flash. And that's where you start getting more creative with the lighting. Because if it's always staying on axis, you can only do so much. Now you could bounce it, not just off the ceiling, but you could bounce it off of a wall, you know, and that then would reflect the light back in and you would get dimension. You might have somebody who has a reflector. We'll be talking about those as well. But there's a lot of different things. So enlarge the light source, as well as taking it off camera, very, very important from the starting point, the moment you take it off camera. Now, there are a lot of off brands, like I have wedding photographers that work for us, our second team, and we give them these Yongnuo units that allow for, we have Canon versions and we have Nikon versions, so they would allow to do off-camera flash as well. So there's a transmitter and a receiver, or transceivers, that we use. Some of these, this is a speed light. Those of you don't know, you're gonna hear the reference of speed lights. This is one of the tools that we take off camera. You'll see us use this a lot And like, we don't do a ton of family portraits, but from that time to time we do, we'll use speed lights. We'll definitely be using them in weddings because they're more mobile, they're smaller, they're more condensed. They allow us to get around a lot easier. Beyond that, you'll see behind me, and you know what, let me go on my keynote because normally I'm used to having an entire day of talking about this stuff and I don't want to take you guys off track. So let me show you the effect of what using off-camera flash can do. Let me go back into a screen share here. Start screen share. I'm going to actually click create that present to everybody just to make sure. What's that? They did? Okay, good, good, good. All right, so here's an engagement session that I did. And with these guys, we used off camera. So we actually used a studio strobe because it was so bright out that day. If you look on the ground, you'll actually see their shadow skidding forward to the right of the camera point of view. That's actually the sun. Our light came in from, you can see from their side, from our point of view being the left side. So we actually brought light coming in because I wanted that contrast, that little bit of edginess. But the stands and everything else that's illuminated there, that's not us. That's actually the hard sunlight. We did this about 11 o'clock in the morning, was when we had access to this football stadium. But you can see now this is a styled shoot. We did the whole going into the park thing the day before. And, this is something that was discussed that we did on purpose. So this is us, but again, you can see the quality light taking it off camera. Now here's one that we just purposely did a flare. This couple originally met in this bookstore in Philadelphia. So we went in there in Old City and they met there. So we did an entire engagement session. I'd say about half their engagement session in the studio. There's just a lens flare moment that happened where my assistant just raised a little bit more and it created this effect. We have others in the series that didn't do that, but we walked around, we created that dimension. You can just see how it's skidding and hitting the books and everything like that. Even though it pulls your eye there, the lens flare there pulls your eye right to them. So that's just a couple different things. Now, again, we had the speed lights that we were just talking about, and those are those smaller lights that, now they do have some limitations unless you do spend for the $2,000 jobbies. They only have so much output in them. So there's limitations, and we'll be talking about that in the fourth, which is the on location webinar. Then there's what's called mono heads and power packs. So with mono heads and power packs, I'm going to bring it back here. To here. So with a mono head, that's where you have basically a studio strobe, and I'll explain this in a second. I'm going to walk back there and grab one. This is on a background stand. So, and we'll take this modifier off real quick. So this is Paul Buff's. This is Paul Buff's version, the Einstein, and I actually took this little protective cover off, which is a little dangerous, but I just wanted to at least show you some aspects. So a typical mono head, what that is everything, the capacitor, the power, the control unit, everything is inside the head itself. So when you can dial this up and down, you know, create, you know, exactly the intensity of what you're looking for. You can test it all out and everything, but everything is inside in the head. Now, if you're doing this, you know, the old school way, that would be tethered. There's actually a little sync thing here, and you would have like a 20-foot plus cord that would go into your camera, and then you plug it in here, and every time you clicked off the shutter, it would fire this off. A lot of us these days are all digital, and we have transceivers or transmitters. So, like, this is their system here. I dropped it earlier on. Back in the day, I used all Pocket Wizards. I still have some of these, but they're very, very expensive, and you can get so many alternatives these days that work incredibly well, not have to invest that type of money in them. But this is a mono head. Now, part of the mono head has two pieces to it. So in this particular case with this Einstein, this middle piece right here, that is actually the modeling lamp. And what the modeling lamp allows you to do is it has constant light that shines constantly while you're trying to adjust the lighting and kind of get a vibe as far as how that light's going to fall. And then you have this flash tube that's around. That's actually the strobe itself that's going to pop off. Now, these are a pretty decent investment. I think these run about $500-$600. I'm not sure. It's been a while since I invested in them. There's different grades. There's different qualities out there. I'm not going to go into brands. Nobody endorses me. Nobody sponsors or tells me what to say or do. So everything I talk about is just stuff that I personally invested in. Getting dry. That's what happens when you talk for an hour. So on the Studio Strobe end, though, that's going to allow you, besides a speed light, that is only going to give you so much power. Now, a speed light, it's only so much weight. It's very portable, and it's easy to get around and do different things. The modifier, the things that you can put on here to do different things are smaller. When you're getting into the strobe, the mono heads, that's going to be your more professional level stuff that you're going to bring in on, you know, for in studio type things, or when you need to, what's called overpower the sun. And those of you that don't understand that, don't know how to do that, like that image that I showed you a couple minutes ago. You know what? I might have a great example. Let me just see here. Okay. Yeah, I'll go too off track if I do that. So we'll keep it simple. So with the mono heads, and I'm going to switch this back just so you can see some different examples of in. Let me go back to the screen share. Okay. Make sure hit present to everyone. All right. So here's an example where I had a couple. This is actually in a parking lot. We were done their wedding that day. We were heading out, saying goodbye. And this is actually in between parking spaces. There's just this little tiny strip. And, you know, with lighting, this is just something you can do. And you can barely see the moon in the upper corner. But it's just something you have the ability to control the ambient light. This is actually a case of speed lights here. So here's where a speed light would have the advantage, because if I just had, and I had a grid on it where I was just hitting them, but I had to balance it out also with the what's going on in the room, with the lights and the chandeliers and the overhead light and fill in, because those lights, while they were nice, they cast a really ugly shadow on the bride, you know, from above. You can only imagine that light coming down and being very contrasty. So I had to fill it in, but I didn't want to hit everything in the room with it. So we use something that's called a grid, and I'm going to show you that in a couple minutes, where we focus that beam in. So we talked about the modeling lamp and flash tube. You can see I've gotten ahead. Okay, constant light, hot lights. I do a thing called the Santa Experience every year, and this is an example. You can see it's very flat. But this example here, this is a live immersion type thing. We actually have a course on this as well called the Santa Experience Course .com. But we have that locked down right now. Like we have a lot of people around the world that are in that program from last year, and we are accepting emails on it, but it's something that we don't actively, we're not allowing anybody in the actual course right this second until we do a launch several months from now, but a relaunch. Now, with this though, this is something that I don't know where these kids are gonna go, because we have a set that's probably about 20 feet wide, and I don't know where these kids are gonna go at any point in time. And that's something that is tricky, because I need to know where they're at, what they're doing. You know, no matter what direction they're in, I need to make sure light hits them. And what I also learned earlier on, because we have some of these kids, they're very, very young, like as young as 3 days old. And I used to use studio strobes and flash the first couple years the first year that we did this. But what I noticed is that the kids constantly turned and looked at the light. And I didn't want the light to be the actual, the focus as far as what they were there for. So what I had to do is come up with a solution, and I'm going to come back off the screen share and just show you that that years ago in my studio, now these are really, really old here, but we have what's called constant light, and constant light is exactly what it sounds like. This is like this one's a 300 watt bulb that's in here. And when you turn it on, it's known as a hot light or constant light. They go, you know, that's going to beam in really, really hot. Now, the downfall is sometimes, it is hot, so it's not safe, especially in a kid environment, because you don't want a light stand to fall or anything like that, or get touched at or whatever, because it is very, very hot. And that's why they used to reference some of those hot lights. But it is constant, so what you see is what you get. Now, these days, they do have different fluorescent style bulbs and systems that you can get that constantly have that light shining. So you do have, and that's what our friend was looking at for the $300 investment range that they were going to do. Now, these days, for the Santa experience, let me grab it over here. Now this has a gel on it, and we'll talk about that another point, but this is an LED panel, so it's just something that Anorama sells, this Flashpoint, that's their private brand, but this is something that this creates a night, it's directional a little bit because you can really fit because it has a hard fall off because of the line right here, but we typically in the CN experience, you just saw that image, we actually angle it to get that bounce light that comes off and comes down. So this is on all the time, just like a flashlight, you know, it's constant. So what you see is what you get. So you can move it around and see the impact live, you know, what, you know, right there, what's happening. So some people opt for this. Now the downfall is, like, let's say in this space right now, I have this beautiful light that's coming in. It's a rainy day outside and I can see this beautiful light coming in. Now the color temperature, you can see how this color is with the gel on right now. If I was to illuminate this, we have two different color lights, right? And the challenge is I might want to eliminate one light versus the other. And a lot of times your ambient light or your constant light, your hot lights aren't powerful enough to override all the existing light that's in a room. But when you're dealing with speed lights and you're dealing with strobes, everything happens so quickly with that shutter flat coming on and off that you can control your settings and be able to make it where you can actually, I can take the camera right now, put in certain settings and make this room that you see right now, I can make it 100% black. And then I can actually add in light. I'm getting, I'm being told how long we've been doing this for in the background. Melissa's keeping me on track. So that's why I'm looking off. So this is something that, you know, we have a gel here and we use this again, and I'll come back and show you, where you see that gel and you're kind of like, oh, well, you're going to compensate. You're going to understand and learn how to modify that light. So that, let me click on this real quick again. So again, right there. So you can see how beautiful that light is. So, but again, we don't know where these kids are going to walk in that scene. So we have to put a multiple light setup in because they could be on one side of the set. They could be looking to the left, looking to the right. And we just need nice, clean light all over the place. So lighting is not always just strobes. Now, with lighting and constant light, it doesn't have to be hot these days. Like I said, there's a lot of different pieces that you can purchase these days. Between all the major suppliers out there. But you want to keep in mind, though, is that you put a lot of money into lighting, and it's something that you need to make sure, and this is where it kills me. So a lot of people out there, they spend a lot of money on lighting itself, and then they go cheap on the stands, the background stands, the, you know, all these type of things. And it kills me because it's like you're spending all this money on professional lighting, and then you go and you go as cheap as possible on the thing that's going to hold that light up. And it's just something I just really want you to just, I know it seems too expensive to spend extra money for those higher quality stands, but do yourself a favor. The worst thing in the world is have a cheap stand or a cheap boom that's going to break and fall in the middle of a shoot, or somebody's going to hit it or kick it. So on a mobile end, we use these Manfrottos that we've had for years, and we've actually even had the studio strobes set up on these, but we use these on weddings and everything because they're compact, like it's very small, you can fit inside the screen here, and it whips down really quick, you know, the legs, and we put an adapter on here, and we actually can put our speed light on it very, very quickly. So we're taking the camera, we're taking the flash off camera. So you have the ability, and this is very portable, very simple. Like we can carry several of these strapped to the camera bag and not have an issue where when you're looking at the big studio stands that you see like in the background right here on both sides, they're going to hold more weight. They're going to be more industrial. They're definitely, if I was going out on a professional shoot, it's something I would invest in, the heavier duty stands. Look for air cushion stands if you can, because the worst thing in the world is to untwist the light, not hold it properly, and have it bang and smash and crack. You know, you don't want to have that in a scenario. Now, I know there's a lot of people out there that are all about do-it-yourself, and there's hacks online that they show you how to do different things. And I'm going to tell you that that might be good for your budget to start, but as you progress, you need to invest in quality professional gear because A, it's more durable and it's going to last you a longer time, but B, from a perception standpoint, if you're walking in with some rickety little thing and trying to tape things together and it's all wacky and looks like a piece of Tupperware or whatever, like it's going to make you look very, very unprofessional. So you need to be careful about that. Now, let me come at, keep my thing going. So we're going to talk about is modifiers. So on the, let me see if I can come back. This is tricky going back and forth on this. So on the modifier side, we have a ton of different type of modifiers. Now, modifiers, when you're going to modify that light, we're going to take it and change and do something different with that light. And we talked about earlier on, when you enlarge that light, it makes it larger. So when we're modifying, when we talk modifiers, we're talking about something that's going to modify, that's going to be attached to the strobe head itself, to the light itself. And to give you some examples, and I'm going to verbally say this, and then we'll come out of the keynote and I'll show you these pieces. But there's different things that can control and change the quality of light. So some of those are what are called reflectors that I'll show you, different size umbrellas. Again, the smaller umbrella, the harsher the light, the larger umbrella, the softer the light. There's different things that are called soft boxes. I'll show you those. There's different qualities of soft boxes. There's what's called a beauty dish, which was over my shoulder a minute ago. Things that are called grids and snoots. Now, I'm going to go ahead and pull back out, and I'm going to take just a couple minutes and show you some of those things real quick. So really, really quick with the going through those modifiers. And let me just put that up on the, so I can go through the list that I showed you a minute ago. So from a reflector standpoint, we have a couple different, we have a 7-inch reflector here. So we're taking that studio strobe, and we're placing, this has adapters. So we're going to place that on here, and that's going to modify the light. It's going to change the quality of the light. So this is going to take it where this is scattering everywhere, and this is going to focus it forward in that pattern. Now, different manufacturers, different types of lights. So if you're shooting sports, like maybe you're at a basketball game or something like that, and you're able to set up a couple high-powered strobes in the corners, you'll find this is called a sports reflector, because this actually, the parabolic curve on this throws light across the room very, very aggressively. And some people are looking for that type of quality of light. So again, it's a larger light source, but just how it's bent is throwing the light forward. Now, again, so it's something coming out of this is gonna be harsh because it's direct light, just like that flashlight, like, you know, it's right on you. So there's a way we can modify that light and maybe have an umbrella. Okay. So like here, I have this umbrella. Oh, look, this is what an assistant did a couple years ago. So those modeling lights are still hot. You see that? They burned that. I'm not sure. I got to come over here, see if I can see that. Yep, you can see it. So that's what you want to be careful of. I know there's a reason why I grabbed this one. But this is a decent size umbrella. So it's going to, now, umbrellas we use for headshots sometimes and for things where we need light to spread, because an umbrella isn't really focused. It's like throwing light everywhere. So It will feather off really well, but it's taking that small light source. So think about it. We're taking something that was this small and harsh, and if we do what's called bouncing through, we would face this in, because that has a black cover behind it, it would reflect light back out. So it's a bounce light. Where this particular umbrella, I actually could take it down, start taking these pieces off right here, and then it becomes what's called a shoot-through umbrella. So I can then instead shoot through it and shoot in that direction. So it'll soften, but don't like shoot-throughs as much just because they still have a hot spot in the middle and it gradates off. But different size umbrellas have different intensities. So this is a medium size umbrella. I have small ones. I have some that are 7-foot large parabolic umbrellas. And that's like window light. Like if you use that, that's like having a window. There's different qualities. So this had a white inside, so that's going to be a little bit softer reflection. There's some that are gold inside. Don't typically recommend that. There's a few exceptions we can talk about at a different time. Then there's silver reflectors. So whenever you get anything that's in the umbrellas, the reflective material in the umbrellas, when it's silver, it's going to throw light faster. It's going to throw it harder. It's reflecting. So it's going to have what's called specular light, which just means there's a little bit more of a shining in it. You'll see it in when you take photos, you'll get a little bit of a harder, contrasty highlights in the camera. So you also have what are called soft boxes. So I'll show you a couple of them that I have in the background here. So right here, if we enlarge in the light source, it's going to get softer. Now the studio strobe goes straight through here. Now this centerpiece here is called a speed light or speed ring. And with the speed ring, that allows you to different manufacturers will have a different type of hookup. So for mine, it's a round hookup, but then the soft box, you don't have to buy a whole bunch of soft boxes because you can switch them out between different manufacturers of lights. So this speed ring can be switched out into whatever your light manufacturer's light is. So now the great thing about soft boxes is that if you come inside, let me see if I can, actually I'll pull this one out over here. Yep, already had this one out. So this is an Octobox. So it's a very large Octobox. You can see it has a silver inside, so it's gonna throw light really hard. But it also has an internal baffle, which will soften that hot spot that's right in the center. So you're gonna have a little bit softer. So you can see how that'll be a little bit better than doing a shoot through umbrella, because it's just hitting that hard spot and there's nothing that's, so there's normally another layer over here, just like that other soft box. But this just shows you again, larger light source, softer the light. You're gonna find a lot of fashion photographers are gonna use this type of light source a lot of times when they're trying to do fashion glamour. When we also have the pan dish that's over here, I believe you guys can see that. It's also known as a beauty dish. So the light is actually hitting the back of that little centerpiece right there. And what happens, there's no direct light. It's just hitting and it's wrapping around, pushing the light forward. It has about 170 degree fall off on it. They can be modified as well. We'll talk about that. Actually, that's the next thing, which are grids. Now I do have several grids for that beauty dish, but also I have grids for different types. So as we can enlarge and get softer, we can also modify and get tighter. So like here, I have this honeycomb grid. This is a 40 degree, and hopefully you can be able to see how that cuts the light right there. Okay, so now this is direct light, so it's gonna be harsher. So we're not using anything that's gonna soften it as much, but now I can direct it. This works great for rim lighting, for hair lights, those type of things. This is a 40 degree grid. Maybe you wanna take it to 20 degrees. Maybe you wanna take it to 10 so that the weave is tighter. So it's letting less light, it's very focused, okay? So these are grids. Now, everything that I'm showing you here that for the studio strobe, you can have the same thing for your speed light as well. So here's what's called a snoot. So this is even more focused. You can see it has a grid in here and then it focuses it even more to a small beam. Maybe you wanna just light something very, very specific and don't wanna have a lot of spill. There's also things called barn doors. I don't see them used as much these days. Have them here, but just want to kind of bring it back. Sorry if that was too far away and you guys couldn't hear. I was just told louder, but probably very late. I was told louder, so I apologize. So real quick, if you use grids, they are very focusable. They're in varying degrees. You can use them for the pan dish or the beauty dish back there. They can be used for the reflectors here. You can put them in and they're, but keep in mind, they're very harsh, but also keep in mind like that tight of weave, like the amount of power they had to push through because it's focusing it, it's actually cutting the light as well. So to get the same effect on whatever you're focused on, you're gonna have to bump up the power in that flash because it's restricting the light from coming through. So again, you can expand light and it gets softer, you can condense it and focus it and it gets harsher, it gets, you know, so a lot of people use that, a lot of the rim lighting we talked about earlier on, we would use that. And again, here's the snoot, that's very, very focused here. And The softboxes I showed you earlier on, they have an internal baffle that's in there as well. Outside of that, there's also other types of modifiers where you actually pull them off. They're not part of, oh, let me show you real quick though. With the speed lights I was just talking about a minute ago, you can take and enlarge the light source. So like here, you know, you can do that. So now I just took this, and this is a mag mod system here that I'm showing real quick, but you can, this is their mag bounce. So those of you who saw me, I was on their Kickstarter video with this piece here. This enlarges the light source, so it's going to be softer. So with this, it's slightly diffused. So what happens, it's still going to push up and do bounce light, but it's also going to arc and push forward. There's a little bit of loss of light that goes the opposite direction, but not that much. So that's enlarging the light source. So we can do the same thing as the strobes. Let me get that off. Sorry, guys. We piled everything on our kitchen table here. here's a grid, and these are stackable. So if you can have varying degrees and stack grids on top of them, each other, you know, over and over, you know, more and more. The also, whenever you take something, whenever you have a modifier that's between the light source and, so whenever you have anything that's in between the light source and the subject, when you're modifying light, those are known as independent modifiers or as gobos. So that's like a go-between. So there's things that you can do that you can create and control light and modify it. And I know I have, I'm going to grab a couple things real quick that I'll show you. But so one of those pieces are called reflectors. So unlike the reflector that's attached, that we talked about a couple minutes ago that was attached, you'll have different reflective, you've probably seen people with these and they're reflecting light back. So even here, let's just, because I know it'll happen. So we have the natural light coming in from the side that's hitting me here. And then we have some darker over here, a little bit of shadow. And maybe for some reason you want it to do that. So if I brought this up and just filled in, see how that's nice, even light? Probably don't want that. It doesn't have as much dimension to it. But even if you aren't using strobes, we use reflectors a lot. Sometimes we're on a very hot, aggressive day as far as the sun's out. And I need to actually, we take some of these things, and when you use them differently, and we have other materials that I can't show you right this second, but we would use what's called a scrim, and that's where we would actually take and block the light, you know, slightly, not 100%, but it would have like diffusion material in it, not as opaque as this, and it would cut the light down. If you're using something that's opaque, let's say, even though this is a white reflector, so this softens a little bit softer. You see that, how that looks different than this silver reflector? See how that's more aggressively reflecting? So softer reflections from white versus silver is a lot harsher. So so that's with umbrellas, that's with reflectors as well. So sometimes you want to fill in light, but sometimes you want to block it. So if you're blocking light, that's called a flag. So I'm going to show you, I'll just utilize this piece right here. But if I take this and take it in front of the window where I'm at, you can see I'm flagging light off. So now I can control light. The background still may be what I want. Maybe I'm going to throw a flash on now and compensate, because this light was probably screwing me up or something. So here's your way. You know, you would want this off camera, of course. That's why assistant or other people are good for you. But those of you that are on, you probably see for a little bit, I do have a, for this first webinar, just trying to go through some random things real quick with you, but you'll probably see an offer that's below that talks a little bit about, I'm finally taking my online intensive class on, or I'm taking my live class and bringing it online, and we're just going to bring on 20 people for a very limited special offer. That way I can get feedback and you can be part of the beta crew over the next month and be able to tell us, you know, what you want, what you need, and you'll get advanced access to everything. And you should see an offer that's on, if you're on the official webinar itself, you should see that offer at this point. We're only going to take on 20 people for that. But it is the live course is a live 10-hour lighting intensive that I've been doing for 10 years now. And let me actually switch over to the next piece here so I can actually talk about that a little bit. That way it makes more sense because I'm looking at myself, so that means you guys are looking at me too. So this month we're doing the four webinars starting at 1 o'clock each week. So I'll be taking off from here and going forward. So next week, one of the things I wanted to talk to you guys about today was the triggers, wireless systems, everything as well. But I'm going to bring that into the camera section for next month or for next week. Now, also, so keep that in mind. So we'll be posting later on tonight a new webinar sign up for you guys to grab that information. But if you don't know where it is, or if you're watching this from Google Hangout or YouTube directly or something, just go to profitographers.com and you'll see the webinar link there, and you'll be able to grab the other webinars as well, depending on when you're watching these. So again, we will be covering the camera aspects next time. So like I was beginning to say, though, is the first week of March, so next month, we'll be officially launching our lighting intensive workshop as an online course. We will be doing two live workshops here in the Philadelphia area this year. We have not released those dates publicly yet, but those of you that are, and it would be in the middle of the week. It's not going to be a weekend thing because we know a lot of people are in weddings and family time on the weekends. But those of you that sign up for the pre-launch will also get an invite to come in for that. And for the last 10 years, I've done this twice a year, every single year, and absolutely 100% every single year I sell out on this workshop. So it's something that I'm hoping those of you that get a little taste of the webinar series might want to have a deeper dive and actually have full-blown conversations, because we'll also have a private Facebook group for everybody that's involved in the Lighting Intensive workshop, as well as every time there's an update. So it's an online course that's forever. It's not just, you know, just pay one time and you get access to the course and the materials and everything. So I sell that course without a discount every single year. I sell it out for $397, the live version of the course. And what I'm going to do is everybody that's on the pre-launch that does come through these webinars, because you cannot find this link anywhere else except right now on the webinars, that we're making it for $97, that actually gets you the online course, and you can be part of our beta group because it's a pre-launch piece. Once we launch next month, we will not offer this price ever again, because this is beyond. This is lighting from ground zero all the way through. There's probably going to be a total of about 15 hours worth of modules that you can get in bite-sized segments for exactly what you need. So if you're doing a headshot today, you can dive right into the headshot stuff. If you're going to do a wedding and need lighting, and dive in on that. If you're just going out doing a fundraiser like event type thing, and dive in on those family portraits, those type of things. And again, this is just for the first 20 people on the webinar, just because we have to protect the pricing and respectfully for those that want to jump on, that want to help as far as like the beta group and everything. Also, we did, I'm not sure if you were here earlier today, but we did officially launch our book last night. It is on Amazon.com for $14.95. You can buy that on Amazon if you'd like, separately for $14.95. But for those that are in the beta group that jump in, that is only $97. So that you'll get all of that. So, and again, there'll be a private Facebook group that'll be ongoing and growing as people invest in the course in the future to get a deeper dive on everything. So we will be jumping into camera settings and everything like that in the next webinar, which will be next week. So of course, it's something that Melissa and I, we do very, very well, very thankful that we do over 800 professional headshots a year. And we do very limited family these days, even though we used to do family, but we just niched in really well. And again, it comes back to that lighting separating us from everybody else, as well as when we have wedding clients that sit in with us. You know, I was at $800 wedding photographer a couple of years ago, when I was rebuilding my life. And it's something like even 2010, I think it was still right around $1,000. And really when I brought in and implemented my lighting and brought that in to separate myself from everybody else, we average over $6,000 per wedding and we book out every year. And it's something that I strongly attribute it to. When clients come in and they want that creative aspect and they want something that not everybody else has. We just had a client actually two nights ago in that they're doing their ceremony at night. They're going to have these twinkle lights and they're explaining everything. And we just talked about how important it is to have a photographer that knows a lot about lighting, because if they hire somebody that is just a natural light shooter, there's not going to be enough light in that space. But in the next couple webinars, we will be covering talking about gelling and color correcting. We're going to talk about camera settings, going to understand that. I'm going to do it as much layman term as possible. But I can only cover so much in these webinars. And it's something that I know a lot of you are struggling and you want that deeper dive. And all the time, everybody says in the group, like, oh, you know, they're so caught up in like, oh, I need to buy that next lens, that next flash, that next piece of gear. And we just heard it this past week in the Prop Photographers group where somebody said, you know what, I need to invest in myself. I need to make an investment in myself. And that's something that I'll keep paying you over and over and over again. But again, today, we're just going to put it up for a few hours. Just for the pre-launch, knowing that people are going to hit this now and then also the replay. But once it's gone, it's gone. Like we can't keep this up at that pricing, because that's actually lower than our Headshots workshop, which, you know, covers less about lighting than what we're going to be diving into the lighting intensive. One extra bonus. So those that do sign up today, you can, like I said, you can come to the live workshop as well. So if you're on this webinar right now and you can make it in 2016 to come to our live workshop, it is available for you. And please 100% understand it's sold for $400. Like I will book it out at $400, but I appreciate those that want to take a small risk and come on with us with the through the webinar, that want to come in and invest their time and their investment to help us mold, to make sure that we answer all the questions that everybody has. And so those that are in part of the beta group this next month, you will actually be able to tell us what you want, and we're going to develop the content around what your needs are. That way nothing is missing out. But what I'd love to do at this point is, those of you that are still on, if you have lighting questions, and those that have questions about this setup, if you want to go ahead, maybe the next 10 minutes, if you can go ahead and shoot me a message through the system, and I have Melissa look to see if there's any questions that come over. There's a couple questions. Okay. I'll repeat it. Can you say it out loud and I'll repeat it? Oops, she wasn't prepared for me. So, yeah. Okay, so what do I use to attach a reflector to a stand if I don't have an assistant? Now, what I would do, there are actually, and we have them here, but I didn't bring it in for today, but I will show it in our follow-up webinars, is we have it's like a boom. It's what, you know, let me come back out of this so I can show you real quick, because I know I have a boom with me that I can show you. So it's similar to the boom, but it's actually made, it's a lighter weight, and it's made for the actual, it has two grip pieces on both ends that'll hold the reflector for you. Now, if you're outside and it's windy or something like that, it's a struggle for a human being to hold those reflectors. So it's something that if you're in a studio or inside or whatever, and you're doing that reflector, let me grab that real quick. So this is a heavy duty, I think it's an Avenger boom. Yeah. So this is a commercial grade boom, but so this would go onto a light stand. You would plug it right down. It's counterweighted, so you need to have a weight on one side. And let me just show you, you have your head over here. So we use this when we need to raise and lower and come underneath our light a lot of times when we're doing headshots and other opportunities, because it expands as well.
but it allows you to raise it up and then you can come actually right underneath, you know, right where the light is to do what you want. But it can also function with clamps. It can hold a reflector as well. You don't need one as strong as this one when you're just holding a reflector though. There's another question.
Do they make a beauty dish for a speed light?
There are a couple. The question was, sorry, let me put that down without hitting my foot. The question is, do they make a beauty dish for the speed light? I've seen a couple variations of beauty dishes out there. I don't have that myself, but I have seen two manufacturers out there that have created some variation of a beauty dish. I just wouldn't know where to send you because we don't use it. We found that this actually has worked really well. And sometimes we actually reverse it and I shoot through this just to diffuse it a little bit more, cut the light down a little bit. But yes, they do make it. I don't know the manufacturer. We do have, for the speed light, we do have soft boxes and octoboxes. They're smaller. I didn't bring them in today. In about 25 minutes or so here, we have to do a headshot. So I have to move all this gear back in a second. What's the... Okay, so LED bulbs for hot lights, as long as you have something that's cutting down the light, because LEDs typically are very focused, you know, and it just creates a hot spot. So as long as you're reflecting it or modifying it somehow, the longevity of LED bulbs are incredible. That's why we use the LED lights for our Santa experience that we do every year. That's because if we used hot lights in that room, because we're in this conference room, right? And we have three lights set up and we have a backup light because we learned the hard way. So when you're dealing with LEDs, they do pull a decent amount of current when you're dealing with a panel like that. And the little adapter went on two of them 2 years ago and we were not prepared for that. So always make sure you have backup. So that's a sign of a professional photographer in general, is to make sure you have backup, which is very important. Sorry, I'm away from the mic here. But I definitely just make sure you're modifying it. That way it doesn't come across as like the flashlight type thing. We are losing light quickly. So what else you have?
It's a long question, but in general, having a hard time getting the light to look soft, even have a soft box and reflectors, does she need a larger soft box?
Okay. I'm not sure how large your soft box is. And, got out of focus there. The question was having a hard time with the light looking soft and even. So what you want to keep in mind, if you bring that soft box closer, it then becomes larger in comparison to, so the moment the soft box is closer, it will begin to wrap around more. The further away it is, just like the sun, even though the sun's so large, it's such a small pin in the sky, it becomes harsher. You know, so you bring that closer to you and then it'll wrap around really nice. Otherwise, it's just moving it slightly. Maybe you just need to cut the light. And now a lot of people, we'll talk about this in the follow-up, is that you also, a lot of times you can take that larger light source and not directly have the light at them, but feather it. So you're gonna just point it in a like this. I'm pointing my hand so it actually shoots this way versus here, that's shooting towards me. And sometimes the feathering will have that nice gradation for you as well. What else do we have?
Can you address photography for a low light wedding ceremony, flash, what and how?
Okay, so can I address low light ceremony, flash, and how? So we're gonna go in more involved in that in our fourth one, which is location. But you're gonna have to understand and get into color correcting gels and also with off-camera flash, and every environment's different. So what's really tricky with answering that question correctly is that I need to take you through several scenarios, and that's what I'm gonna do in that work, in that webinar. So make sure that you tune in to that one as well, so I can cover that in detail, because there's a lot of different variables and factors. It's hard to explain in like one sentence to answer that question. Is there any?
What's the best lighting for bright, sunny day and shade?
So what's the best, say that again?
Best lighting for a bright, sunny day and shade.
Okay, so whenever you're in a bright, sunny light and shade, it comes back to what you wanna do. And that's the trick with lighting, is that you wanna learn lighting to the point where you can get exactly what you want, not just learn somebody's lighting setup and go, okay, I need to have this at a 45 degree and at this temperature, I need this one to be at another 45 degree in this angle. And you wanna learn lighting to the point And it's hard because it's like anything new. It's you know, the unconscious incompetence, you know, where you don't know what you don't know, and then you get rattled, like, oh my goodness, I don't understand this, and you get worried and scared. And once you do things over and over and over again, then you get to the point where it becomes part of you. And that's where you have to get with lighting. You have to do it more and more in order to understand it. So we a lot of times we look for open shade, and that's where you're in harsh light, and try to make the background, we'll talk about this more in the last webinar as well, but make the background level out with that. Some there's reasons why you want to have that hot light sometimes behind them. Most of the time you're probably going to have a shaded side behind them as well, and then you introduce your own light as well. But what we do in weddings, what we do in portraits, as well as what we do in that situation with headshots, with corporate headshots that we encounter as well. Because sometimes we're in a situation where their availability for this attorney is at 12 o'clock noon outside, and it's totally open light, and we have to get creative on how we're going to balance it all out. What other questions?
I just wanted to review how to get the link to the beta program.
Okay. Hopefully the link to the beta program is actually on the software. So I can't physically see that right now. And if the software did what it was supposed to do, it's actually probably going to disappear in the next minute. So what you want to do though is if you, for some reason, and what I'll do is, so some people on here, they might've missed that link. If you can, in that chat box, if you can email us like they just did, I'll send you the private link. Just please don't share with anybody, because we are not opening this up to everybody, just the people that are on the webinar. It is very limited, very exclusive, and I just don't. Yeah, so if you want that link, just send an email or a message to us right now that says, please send link, and I'll make sure that you get that beta link just to come in with the group at the special price with the incentives that we talked about. Anything else that we have right now?
Last question. Would you rather saturate with light to get a sharp shot, or be creative with lighting and deal with noise?
Okay, so would I say that? Give me the first part and I'll repeat that.
Would you rather saturate with light?
Would I rather saturate with light?
To get a sharp shot.
To get a sharp shot.
Or be creative with lighting and deal with noise?
And be creative and both. That's the hard thing. It all depends on what you're looking to do. So I've been in a lot of low light situations where I don't care as much about the noise. Now keep in mind also, a lot of pro photographers won't admit this, but if you have an entry level camera and it can't handle ISO, like high ISO very well, your noise is going to look like crap, and there's nothing that you can get around that. And no matter, even with the better lenses and everything else, letting more light in, it's just something, if you have a very dimly lit, it's going to look not as good as if you invest in a better camera and had a better piece of gear, because it's going to be able to grab that information, and it's going to look like the old school grain of a film camera, where it just looks beautiful, even though it might not be perfect and tack sharp. But we go both ways, depending on the situation. So we might purposely, you know, eliminate the ambient light, which we'll be covering this in the next webinar, actually, when we go through camera settings and everything. I'm going to show you how you can control and push the camera one direction or the other to get a desired result. And that's where I think a lot of people get really excited, where we can take an image, like I have one that I'll show next time that was done at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, bright, hard sunlight. And we brought a studio strobe out with us and purposely did what's called overpowering the sun. And we made it look like it was about 8 o'clock at night. And, you know, with a reflection in a pond and everything, it was beautiful. But everybody swears up and down, we must have did that at like 8 o'clock at night. And really was hard sunlight in the middle of the day. And we pushed the camera and the lighting to do exactly what we wanted to do. So you can get more creative. But again, the whole idea is for when you're asking that question, it just means that you have to make a creative choice and purposely go in the direction that you want. Now, if it's a moment they can control and you have extra time, you can do both. You know, but if you're in, like, if you have to sacrifice one, but I like to go one direction if I can, then purposely push the camera in the other direction and give them both effects. Is that it? I think we have to wrap up, because Melissa's looking at the time and she's like, "Ooh, we got to set up for the headshot session that's coming in." But again, those of you that did not get the proper link that we posted up, if you can hit us up directly, and if you're watching this webinar from somewhere else and you don't know how to hit us up because you don't see a chat, just email us at VIP@paulpruitt.com. Again, that's VIP at paulpruitt.com. And that's PaulPruitt.com. And Melissa and I will be able to get back to you. Give us a little time because we are, as soon as we break this down, we are going in and setting up. If anything, invest in our new book. Go to Amazon.com, type in Profitographers, and grab that book. Hopefully that'll help you out as it already did with people that we had that beta test and gave us feedback on the writing of the book before. And beyond that, as we always say on our podcast every week, so stay on iTunes also or Stitcher Radio. We do podcasts every week, free podcasts, as well as these free webinars. Stay profitable. Thanks, everybody. Talk to you soon. Now we got to get to work. Bye.